Welcome to Doxa Deo City Changers.
In heaven and heaven and nature. Hallelujah, What a glorious time of year this is. It's a time to celebrate family. It's a time to celebrate love. It's a time to celebrate Christmas. It's not a good time to go to the shops, though. It's one of the mistakes I often make, that I forgot to buy somebody a gift, and then at the last moment, I go and stand in those long queues. But anyway, it's such a glorious time. Unfortunately, some Christians build up a lot of tension around this time. How should we navigate with how Christmas has been commercialized? And what does the Bible say? What is the correct approach? What could be the correct content to fill this time of the year and know, you know, that we're doing the right thing, that we truly honor the Lord Jesus Christ? There are so many questions and so many comments, and one of them starts with the fact that we do not believe that Jesus was born around the 25th of December. All indications are that he probably was born rather in the month of September. But what we do as Christians is that we dedicate this time of the year to celebrate his birth. Now, just for interest's sake, I was born on the 27th of December, and I mean, you can imagine that's not a good time to throw a party of any sorts. Everybody is worn out with all of the year-end functions and with their Christmas parties and so on. So I also had to learn to move my birthday to another date and to accommodate some of the rhythms of life. Shall we talk through this? And I would like to share a personal conviction of how I and how my family approach this time of the year. So those tensions in regards to, is it the correct time to celebrate the birth of Jesus? We'll talk about those. There are other tensions relating to some of the symbols that have become popular around the Christmas season. And people feel, you know, maybe some of those symbols have their origin in pagan worship. And it's actually a very dangerous thing to do, to celebrate Christmas as the world celebrates Christmas today. So I'd like to address some of those today and give you some wisdom on how I think the New Testament helps us and guides us to celebrate Christmas in such a way that it really honors the Lord Jesus Christ. I do want to start by stating that I do celebrate Christmas in December. And I think it is quite important that we start with the whole premise of the New Testament, that Jesus Christ is alive and he's part of our lives on a daily basis. Practically, emotionally, spiritually, there's absolutely no difference between 25 December and 26 December. As far as my experience of the Lord Jesus Christ is concerned, he is Lord of my life on a daily basis. As a Christian who is filled with Christ and who has become the temple of the Holy Spirit, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, as a Christian filled with the presence of God, there is also no difference between a Sunday and a Monday. The fact that we dedicate a Sunday as Christians towards coming together as the body of Christ, worshiping the Lord, loving his presence, coming together as spiritual family, that heightens our awareness of God's presence maybe on a Sunday. But in my walk with God, he is part of every minute of every hour, everywhere I go. Jesus is in me and he is with me. So Christmas to me is not a special day in terms of God's presence. It is a special day, the 25th of December, as our Christian fathers have decided decades, thousands of years ago, they decided that they want to call a feast. They want to call a time of celebration around the 25th of December. Now, every feast actually just emphasizes a particular truth. And if you understand it in that way, Christmas could have been on any other date. It is a time in the year that we choose globally as a Christian body. It is a time that we choose to celebrate the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. his incarnation and the fact that God became man. Those are some of the huge themes in Christianity as we understand the sacrifice that our God made to put himself in our shoes. And we want to celebrate that. It has changed the course of history. And I want you to think deeply about the fact that this feast doesn't have to be on the right date, the day that Jesus was born. It is just the day that we set apart to celebrate the fact that our God became flesh. He walked amongst us. And we'll look at one or two of those scriptures in a minute. So if we then understand that Christianity has forever taken this principle that God put on humanity, he put on the culture of the Hebrew people of the day. If we understand that principle, then you will understand that Christianity has for ages also taken meaning to certain normal cultural elements in society. Let me just give you one or two examples as I read John chapter 1 verse 14 that says, "The Word became flesh and blood and moved into our neighborhood." This is the Message translation. The Word became flesh and blood and moved into our neighborhood. That means that God clothed himself with our culture, with our humanity, and he brought new meaning to our humanity and to our culture. If we continue with that scripture in the Message translation, John chapter 1 verse 14, it says, "We saw the glory of this God with our own eyes, the one of a kind glory, like Father, like Son, generous inside and out, and true from start to finish." Now, one of the clear examples of how Christianity has taken on certain cultural elements is just in the way that we name our days. I mean, we talk about Sunday and Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday without really thinking what we are saying. Sunday was the day that was dedicated to the worship of the sun god. Thursday was dedicated Saturday to Saturnus, you know, to all of the gods in the Greek-Roman history and how people related to spirituality at that point. And as Christians, we take the Sunday and we dedicate, we give new meaning to a day where other people used to worship the sun god. We decided that we are going to worship the Son of God. He is the Son of Righteousness, according to Malachi. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. And you see how the incarnation of Jesus Christ is something that Christianity has been playing out into our cultural reference forever. It's true also for just the clothes that we wear. If you engage a Christian in India, or a Christian in the USA or Australia or South Africa or somewhere in Central Africa, you will see that people still dress themselves within their natural culture. But the life of Jesus Christ comes and he transforms the way that we do life, the way that we do marriage, the way that we do business, and all of those different elements. I'm just stating that Christianity is about the Lord Jesus Christ becoming flesh. And it is true that there were pagans who, around the 22nd and the 23rd of December, when the sun turns in the northern hemisphere, and when the winter stops and actually the new season is announced, there were some pagan rituals. And it is true that the church fathers of the day said, this is the season where we want to celebrate the new life that God brought to our planet. But the fact that that is in proximity, that it is close to each other, doesn't bother me at all. because then it would have to bother me that we have our church meetings on a Sunday. There are just too many elements of what the enemy is doing that if I had to take notice of that, I wouldn't have the freedom that I have received in the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to state it very clearly. I celebrate Christmas around December, around the 25th of December, and I'm going to give you one or two of the dimensions of how I do it. But I am not a slave to some of the fear that drives people to say, no, I'm not going to touch any of the elements of Christmas, because I understand that Jesus became flesh. He took on our humanity. He took on our culture and he redeemed it. And I think Christianity is about redeeming people, redeeming their culture, redeeming moments like this one, where the whole world is feasting and celebrating relationships and celebrating with gifts and so on. So there are some of the symbols in this time around Christmas that if we could take the meaning that Christ brings to our lives and take it to those symbols, I think it could liberate us. It could set us free so that we could celebrate Christmas, but do it for the right reasons and with the right meaning behind those reasons. So maybe some of the tension that you may experience is between the what and the how. The what is we want to celebrate the birth of Christ. The how could have some elements to it where I say, okay, yes, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do that. But this is the way that we do celebrate Christmas. Now, I want to state it like this. I don't think that the devil is necessarily in the symbols behind Christmas. I think that some of those symbols, let's start, for instance, with St. Nicholas. He was a Christian leader who around this time just reached out to some poor children, and people were so inspired by it that we have some of the leftovers of what he used to do in what is today known as Father Christmas. And I do agree that some pagan elements came into this whole symbol and the concept of if you were a good child, you're going to get a gift, and if you were bad, you're not going to get a gift. That is absolutely unbiblical. So there are some of those dimensions that we can cut out. But the concept of buying gifts around this time, celebrating family, appreciating somebody, that particular notion doesn't have anything evil behind it. We take meaning to that. So I actually promote this. I tell people this is a fantastic time of the year to celebrate the people who are close to you. You know, one of the biggest challenges of the church is that we sometimes believe that God only works and God actually lives in holy spaces and in holy places. That we experience God when we go to certain holy meetings in certain cathedrals and places like that. While I think that there is something special about a building that's got great acoustics and that's got brilliant architecture, I do not think that that actually differs from a beautiful marula tree out in the bushveld, or that differs from a rock by the sea where you're sitting and enjoying the scenery. And the sense of the presence of God is not connected to a place. Christmas is actually one of those stunning seasons in the year where we take the Lord Jesus home with us. It's the music that plays in the shops, in our homes, that elevates the awareness that he became flesh and he is with us. It's the conversations, it's the extra moments where we gather with our family, we light candles, and some people say you can't light candles because that relates back to some of the traditions of the pagans when they worship the sun that is turning around. And I'm saying, where do you get that? Whenever did pagan worshippers, did they own candlelight? We take meaning to these moments. If you have a special lunch or a dinner with your family, and you're using candles, you're using music, even if you want to use incense, we don't like that. But if you want to do that, we take meaning to natural cultural elements of society. And what we cannot afford to miss is that the meaning of Christ who became flesh, he dwelt amongst us, that we celebrate that in our homes. We don't have to do that in cathedrals. We take Christ home with us in this time of Christmas. And that's why I like celebrating Christmas with my family and with my friends. Let's look at Colossians 1:15 again. It says, we look at this Son, the Son of God, and we see the God who cannot be seen. Christmas to me is a time where his presence is just put on display. It's made visible with the love that people have for one another. Just the tolerance, the fact that we celebrate the uniqueness, that we take care of each other, that we love each other. This God that cannot be seen is put on display. The fact that we look out for people who are stuck in poverty and are struggling, and we are caring for them. All of those elements. We look at the Son, Colossians 1:15, and we see the God who cannot be seen. We look at the Son, and we see God's original purpose in everything that was created. Everything on this planet is a gift from the living God. That includes lights and light and candles. It includes the sunrise. It includes the summer in South Africa and the Southern Hemisphere. Christmas for us is a glorious time of warmth in so many ways. So spacious is he, Colossians 1:19. So roomy that everything of God finds its proper place in him without crowding. Come on, I want to challenge you. It's Christmas time. Let us celebrate Christ. The word Christmas comes from Christ Mass. It was a time where our church fathers, decades, thousands of years ago, said, this is a time where we will break bread together and we will celebrate the fact that Christ is in us and he is amongst us. So people ask me, John, do you put up a tree, a Christmas tree? Because that is one of the demonic elements. And I'm again saying, you know, everything on this planet is a gift from God. I do put up a tree. The early church fathers decided that the tree with its triangular shape would represent something of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You know, and again, we don't have to bring that kind of meaning to that symbol. But the tree for me symbolizes life. It symbolizes the gift of what God gave us on this planet. And we do put some gifts around the tree, and we have that moment as a family where we open them and we celebrate the love that we received in the first place from our Heavenly Father. I like to put up lights, and we do Christmas pudding and all of those elements. It's a family celebration, and I want to encourage you to do that. The problem for me is when we do not celebrate Jesus Christ anymore. And that I agree with. I see so much happening in society, so much happening in our culture, where people spend so much money that the reason for Christmas, the concept of a giving, generous Father, that reason sometimes gets lost. That's why I say celebrate Christ in this season. Celebrate the gift of God. Celebrate the gift of the people around you, and flood it with meaning for you and for your family. It doesn't actually matter how you do it. The what is more important. I think the second thing that we do every year around this time is not just to take care of our own, but to look up a little bit around us and see people around us who really suffer at this time. You know, if you lost a loved one in this last year, Christmas is a very tough time for you. So just look up a little bit and maybe see if there's somebody in your community, somebody in your proximity that's really going through a tough time. This is the best time of the year just to be generous to them as well. As a church community, we always do a Christmas wish list. We love to reach out to people. you know, older people and orphans and people who are just suffering, people who are just lonely at this time of year. Unfortunately, it's also true that a lot of people do not feel that they have hope for the future. And this is a time for the church to shine in our communities. Everybody in the Southern Hemisphere is on holiday and is celebrating just a time of rest, flooded with Christ-like meaning. And say, thank you, Lord, that you are the gift giver and that we have the opportunity to do the same for one another. The last component of what I think we should do in this time, the Christmas time, is a fantastic time to tell stories. Just to read the story of the birth of Jesus inspires emotion about his love for humanity. To tell your own story to your children. This is a season where we have a lot of time around dinner tables, lunch tables, breakfast tables, where we have family time at an increased level. It is a time to tell stories. Where do we come from? What are the values that God has laid on our hearts, that God has established in our lives over seasons? It is a time to bring our children to a place where we celebrate what is really important. It is a time to infuse hope. And the story of Christ, the story of my life, the story of December is a story of hope. I want to pray that you will go back in these couple of days that are left and flood it with the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is such a good time to also just look forward to the year that is coming and to say, Lord, thank you that you became flesh so that every day of my life can be Christmas Day. Let's celebrate Jesus. He is Emmanuel. God is with us.
On the program today, I reckon we have a legend here, in my mind, nevertheless. Werner Janssen van Rensburg, who's been affecting the lives of young people for many years now. Werner, it's great to have you here.
Thank you
for your time, and I'm looking forward to this because I know what we're going to talk about, and that's clearly written there on your shirt. We're going to get into Metamorpho and exactly what it stands for soon, but quickly just tell us, where did you grow up? Just who is Werner? Introduce yourself to the people.
I'm Werner. Was born in Kempton Park, and then went to high school in Potchefstroom. Came to after Potchefstroom Gymnasium, mm-hmm. came to Metamorpho, changed my whole life, and ever since from there, part of the leadership, and luckily the last 3 years I'm leading the team of Metamorpho.
Fantastic. And married?
Married for 9 years now.
Great.
Do have a 2-year-old daughter.
Fantastic.
And the second one is on its way in January.
Yeah, yeah. Beautiful. Yeah. Growing ministry.
Growing the ministry, yeah.
Werner, now Metamorpho has been happening for many years now. It's over 20 years.
It's now 20 years this
20
year.
20 years. Maybe just give us a bit of the background. How did it come to exist? What's the heart behind it? And then we'll continue to discuss on, you know, what's happening currently.
We look at the youth, and we saw the youth as struggling with where they want to go.
After school now.
After school. Mm-hmm. And struggling with who they are. A lot of stuff happens during our teens, in our lives, in our houses. And to get out of that and fully understand our identity and to make our decisions with our truth, it's hard. And especially currently, for myself, it was, I saw the teenagers in the environment that they're in. Mm. We live in an environment which is fast. Information overload.
True.
They are bombarded with information.
And in that, they have to make decisions.
They need to make decisions and
affecting their lives.
We are safety conscious. Mm. That steals some of their courage, some of their risk taking in their lives. And that I've experienced the youth being passive, depressed, no hope, no faith, and the brokenness that happens because of how they discover themselves in society, how they position themselves in relationship. And I had just compassion for that.
And it's scary because those are the young people that make decisions in that time that affects the rest of their lives. Yes. So if you want to think, what is the right mindset to have before you make decisions that will bear fruit or not? For, I mean, what you're going to study, where you find yourself engaging with community. So no wonder people are confused in life, because at the time when these decisions are being made, they've got, like you're saying, an information overload. And in that, very few times, they really know who they are. And that's probably one of the biggest things that Metamorpho actually help these people discover. Yeah. Then maybe take us through the process. So these kids are leaving school. They now need to find themselves. What is Metamorpho focusing on to guide these people in this reality you just made us aware of?
Yeah, the process, and like I said, I went through it myself, and I was confused when I came out of high school. And the first thing was, a lot of stuff happened. I lost my dad when I was 9 years old. The questions I had, being a man, and where do I fit in, how the example of being a husband, a marriage. And I think the first thing is to unlock the past for the youth, is that the past is not a baggage. It's not a burden. But God wants to use that as a testimony for the stuff that happens in our life. And that we don't make decisions out of lies and out of hurt because of our past. But rather that they will get healing from it.
And deal with it. Hey?
Deal with it and say, God wants to use it and use that testimony even for those around you. So that's the first thing, is that we unlock the past. That God wants to engage the inner healing process. That will not keep you from having a full life and a full future. The second thing is help so the students discover their authenticity, to unlock the present me. What God has placed in me, the skills, the personality, who I am as a leader, what type of leader I am, the potential, and that gives them the confidence. And with that is to fully understand the truth of my identity in Christ. And through the identity of Christ, who I am, then discover the skills, then the abilities. Now I can position myself in society. Now I can say, yes, this is where I fit in society. Now I can position myself. And then the last thing is one of the most biggest thing in our lives is relationship. We have relationships everywhere we go. We are connected. In our workplace, in our families, in our marriages with our children. And who taught us to have relationship? Relationship intelligence, we talk about it in the workplace, to have conflict, emotional intelligence. And nobody sits down with the youth and say, but this is what it is. And how do we define our emotions? What is our emotional vocabulary? So that we know it's not just good or bad and we struggle with bipolar, but that we can have vocabulary for the challenges in our lives and that we can engage in relationship. So we stand still at the end of the year with who's your mentors? Who's your accountability partners? Who's the people that you are discipling? How will your marriage look like? How would your culture of family look like? And that I will be a city changer. I will be the person that takes responsibility in my environment and in the relationships that I'm in. How do I engage it so that I can, that it would flourish? It's not other people that makes it flourish. They will make, myself will make it flourish in the environment.
So it's basically giving them a Christ-centered reference from which to make good decisions now. Instead of responding to the brokenness or, like you're saying, whatever the past dictated, to unlock that, like you're saying, find Christ in your current reality, and then saying, listen, from this current reality, from this bigger reference to God being in you, in which image you were created, now make good decisions. Question to you on that, Vander, is how do you measure the effect of that? Can you see in the choices they make afterwards? I mean, at least you're one example of that. Mm-hmm. You made some good choices after going through it yourself. But the effect that you see in people around you, what do you see in comparison to maybe youth post-school that is not going through process like that, who just jump straight into whatever course they applied for and went in? Do we see that these kind of adventures with one another, with God, is having an effect?
I think there's two things. The first comment is what is nice is in Jeremiah 29 verse 11, for God knows the plans that he has for us. And it's the time of our lives so that we can stand still and engage in that. But to answer your question, I think the culture of relationship is to stand still in this whole rat race of our lives, that we follow the mainstream school, high school, and we don't stand still. I think one of the biggest thing that what we see is the culture and the community that is built in Metamorpho, is that we can't go alone through life. God made us to live in community. And the friendship and the depth of friendship and the mindset of continuously learning, being teachable, being humble, being vulnerable, is something that we see. If I look at students that just go through the mainstream, follow the mainstream, and students that stop for a year and say, God, I want to know the plans that you have for me. Again, being in the fullness of Christ, engaging one another in the body of Christ, understanding that we need the body, we are the body, and then we need to be discipled and to be disciples. And I think the difference, one of the big differences, no matter where they go, study engineer, medicine, whatever, is the fundamental subculture that Metamorpho creates, is that the connection, the vulnerability, the teachability, the constantly pursuing God's will for my life in every area. And it's not that you are perfect after Metamorpho, but the culture that they're in is, I want to discover God's glory, that in 2 Corinthians 3:18, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of God, we are being transformed from glory to glory. And it's everywhere they go, everywhere, in every environment, that they will seek God there and transform and be transformed from glory to glory. And I think it's a fundamental thing. It's not...
It's not the end in itself. Hey? Yeah. You set them on a journey of discovering what they have received as children of God. So it's not the end when they leave there. It's actually just saying, now the relationships that you have, the knowledge they have, the experience that you have, use that in growing from glory to glory into that which God has prepared for you.
Absolutely. And I think it's, if you want to go to Cape Town and you head north, you have a problem.
Unless you're going from Iceland, hey?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And for me, it's actually to... I see Metamorpho as just positioning them in the right direction, in their mindset, in who they understand, who they are, the self-awareness. And in that, the journey starts. Actually, after Metamorpho, what they've been taught, what they realized, now I go into this world, and with the right mindset, now I'm heading in the right direction.
Werner, people listening to this might feel that, you know, I can't waste a year. I need to get studying. It's expensive, but this is such an investment. It's actually something you can't afford not to do to prepare you. And I know people looking at this will ask the question, you know, where, how, what can I do? For people that say, I've got a teenager in grade 11 or 12 asking questions, what's next, wanting to engage in this, want to have a year of really investing in who they are, what do they do?
First thing they can do is they can go to our website. There's a lot of information there about how the process works, the nuts and bolts of Metamorpho. And then we've got information sessions every month. There's two information sessions in November and December. The registration ends at the end of January. So the process starts in the end of January. So if they want to be part of the process for 2019, they're more than welcome to join the information session.
Okay.
And so everything is on the website, or they can just phone if they want to speak to us, and we will give
help them on the way.
Hey?
Yeah. Vanda, this is exciting. I think City Changers are being born at Metamorpho. Mm-hmm. Two of my siblings went through it, and I can see what it's done in their lives as well. And may God continue to use this wonderful process to transform people, replace brokenness with wholeness, and set them up for the course of their life. And may God protect you and your family, and may the good work continue to flow through your hands and from your heart into the lives of those people. So thank you for your time. Bless you.
Thank you, Tops.
One thing that I've constantly been thinking about is the goals, or the goal of life, or why do we need to have goals, one side, and secondly, what are we trying to do on this earth? And I always thought that happiness was the goal of life. And I saw happiness as a wheel with different spikes in it. And then you have all these different things that makes you happy. So to a large extent, in my mind, you ended up with almost the absence of light is darkness. So try to explain my concept is that people is usually happy. It's the natural state supposed to be. But if you take health away, it's almost the absence of light and people get unhappy. So then the second one, if you're not financially sound at certain stages, that really is tough for you and you feel under pressure. So in a large extent, I think you get the concept that each of these stuff in your life, if you and your wife is not in a good place, that will subtract to a large extent your happiness or take away the light. And so I always thought that was the only goal for people is happiness. I had to realize that some of the previous philosophers and so on were really talking about power, and that power is actually the goal. And how do you bring this power and happiness as two different goals in life? So for me, once again, to start there might be the wrong end of the stick, but in a matrix that I built for myself was, so if I make the right choices, it's in the middle, right choices. What will allow me to make the right choices? Remember, I'm going to the goal. So right choices on the one side is almost academic knowledge through consciousness. So you're sitting with academic, financial, and practical knowledge so that you make the right decision. But that's not all you need, because sometimes you have all the information and you still make the wrong decision because you don't bring in values or morals or religion to it. Without the right moral side, you will not make the right decision. Wisdom alone on world mindsets, I don't think is the solution alone. So you have choices and you have the information on this side and you have the morals and religion on this side, and then you're supposed to make the right decision. The big problem is sometimes you do all those and the timing is not right to make the right decision. So from there, sometimes that's a failure in what you do. The one up is success. So if success is getting what you want, so what do we want in life? In my life, I really want to be married with my wife until I die. I want my children to come and visit me, out of own free will. I don't want to force them to come and visit me. I really want to fly business class when I'm retired. I'm a little bit tall. Obviously, I want to make a huge impact on the people that's working with us in our company. I want to put a safe place. We've got 1,000 people working for us, and it makes me so proud to have this impact on people's lives, only if it's on a financial point of view. And so that is a real nice goal for me to expand on that. But having this happiness, will that be the day when I'm happy? I don't think so, because that's not the goal, to be happy alone on stuff that you get. So out of a thinking environment, this goal setting, we need to be very careful, because our purpose is still, how do we get to God, and how do we get to the afterlife, and how do we understand that whole thinking, believing environment? And I think that is the greatest challenge in a normal life in the world, where you have different people that constantly do have exposure to you. And so that's a challenge that I constantly have. I feel that the only real foundation that I can work on is the Bible. And the Bible is busy with these questions for 3,000 years. I do believe that a lot has been distilled or percolated in the Bible. And we need to look at the Bible much deeper today and interpret differently than in the past, and really look for the wisdom that God gave us in this book. And according to me, to define the goal, I was really looking out of a economic point to get to a word. How do I explain the goal in one word? And one day at church, they were speaking about shalom, and they gave the definition. And basically, it's peace, harmony, tranquility, wealth, health. And that is almost the goal of life. And I started with this whole absence of light thinking of a goal. And I hope that we know that God were really in his love for us, really focusing on the shalom. And I hope that everybody can understand that this goal is really the way to happiness.